got your Bible, go with me to Luke chapter 15. Luke chapter 15 is where we're going to be today. And one of the main reasons why I was so excited about today is because we're starting a new series. And I love the idea of it. When I was praying one day and God shared it with me, and I thought, man, that is a fantastic idea, God. And he was like, yeah, I come up with those, you know. And so I was really excited about it. I'm very excited to start the series. We're going to start. It's called Reflections is the series name. And so we're going to start it in Luke chapter 15. And that's what these mirrors are all about. If you look all over the room, there's mirrors. And I think one of my kids is starting the hashtag Keep the Mirrors Fund. And so that's a thing that's going on now. He's like almost in protest because I told him the mirrors were only for the series. And he said, no, that's not good enough for me. We need to keep the mirrors. And so I think he's starting a kind of a hostile takeover if I try to take one of these mirrors down. So he will soon realize that the mirrors will serve their purpose, and then some of them might stay, some of them are going to go. So you like the mirrors too? Okay, well, it's not up for a vote. So, no, I'm just joking. Luke chapter 15, if you're there, shout me an amen. Amen. All right, you'll wake up eventually, because if you don't, I'll wake you up. So it's all good today. We're ready to go. Luke chapter 15, we're going to start at verse 11, something that everybody's probably heard before. If you haven't heard it before, then you're in for a treat, because we're going to talk about it today. This is what Jesus said, verse 11. A certain man had two sons, and the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portions of goods that falls to me. So he divided them his livelihood. See, what you need to understand is that this dude then went to his daddy and said, Daddy, I want you to give me what's mine. And in that culture and in that time, what he basically said is, Dad, your job here is done. I wish you were dead. Because the only time you got the inheritance was when the father passed away. So for this kid to go to his father and say, give me what's mine, it wasn't his yet. And so he goes to his dad in a disrespectful way, and he says, Dad, give me the stuff that's mine. Verse 13, and not many days after, the younger son gathered all together, everything he had, and journeyed to a far-off country, and there wasted his possessions with prodigal living. But when he had spent all, there arose a severe famine in the land. Doesn't it suck when you run out of money and then the grocery stores close down? There was a severe famine in the land, and he began to be in want. And then he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him into the field to feed the swine. And he would have gladly filled his stomach with the pods that the swine ate, and no one gave him anything. But when he came to himself, I need you to say came to himself. Those three words are my favorite part of this whole story. When he came to himself, he said, how many of my father's hired servants have bread enough and to spare, and I perish with hunger? I will arise and go to my father's house, and I will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you, and I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants. And he arose and came to his father, but when he was still a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion on him and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. And the son said to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in your sight, and I am no longer worthy to be called your son. But his father said to his servants, bring out the best robe and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand and sandals on his feet, and bring the fatted calf here and kill it. And let us eat and be merry, for this my son that was dead is alive again, and he was lost and is found, and they began to be merry. Now the older son, the player hater, he looked and said, as he drew near to the house, he heard music and dancing. So he called to one of the servants, and he said to these men, and he said, your brother has come home because, let me start that over, verse 27, and he said to him, your brother has come, and because he has received him safe and sound, your father has killed the fatted calf. But he was angry and would not go in. Therefore, the father came out and pleaded with him. So he said, Father, I have been with you these many years serving you. I've never transgressed your commandments at any time, yet you never gave me the goat. I might make merry with my friends. You never threw a party for me, and I've been here the whole time. But as soon as the son of yours came home, who took everything you had and wasted it with harlots And you kill the fatted calf for him. You throw the party for the one that took everything. And he said to him, son, you're always with me, and all that I have is yours. It was right that we should make merry and be glad, for your brother was dead and is alive again, and he was lost and now is found. I want to look at this verse right here, number 19. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me one of your hired servants. And I want to talk about the subject of identity crisis. The identity crisis is when you go from being a son to a servant. The identity crisis is when you go from being what you were made to be and created to be and born to be to putting yourself in a situation where you have to be something completely outside of your call. Identity crisis. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for this day. I thank you for all that you've done so far and all that you will do as we continue to get into your presence. I pray, God, that you would have your way in this service, that you would do what only you can do. Bless us today in Jesus' name. Amen. Let me give you a statement. The crisis, the identity crisis, the crisis is cured at the cross. The crisis is cured at the cross. What that means is that when we don't understand who we are, we can always find who we are in the cross of Jesus. There is something that goes on when we get into the presence of God, when we get at the cross of Jesus, and when we get down on our knees and we identify with what he did on that cross. See, every time you see a picture of Jesus on the cross, what you should do right then is identify, and you should put yourself in that picture, because that should have been me and that should have been you. But God was so good and so merciful to us that he took the punishment that we should have had and he put it on himself so that we could be identified as sons and no longer enemies of God. That we could be identified as somebody who he was willing to die for and not somebody who he was willing to fight against. We are now the people, the family, the children of God because of what happened at the cross. The dictionary defines identity as the condition of being oneself or itself. Your identity is who you are. It makes you you. It makes you a unique person. That there might be 400,000 other 6-foot-ish bald guys with a beard. But there is something unique about me that makes me what I am, and it is because that is my identity. That is what makes me me. And there is something inside of you that is unique to you that is what makes you you. Your identity is not something that we can get confused with. And I think today, in today's society, everybody wants to have some different identity. Nobody wants to be what they were created to be. Nobody wants to live the life they were made to live. Everybody wants to identify as something else. I'm going to identify. White folks want to identify as being black folks and lead in the NAACP program in some state. And black folks want to identify as white folks. And men want to identify as women. And women want to identify as men. And people want to identify with animals. And everybody wants to live in some sort of crazy, chaotic society where it doesn't matter what bathroom you go in. It doesn't matter what clothes you wear. You can be as crazy as you want to, as long as you identify with something else. And everybody's going crazy because of this identity issue. There's gender identities, there's racial identities, there's financial identities, there's all these things that people are, that are constantly in the news. And I just watch the news and I want to cut it off and say, stop talking. I'm not interested in your identity crisis. But everybody faces one. And there is one place that we go to get past the identity crisis, and it is to Jesus. Yeah. Now, see, let me share something about myself. I've never really had an identity crisis. I've always known exactly who I was. But when I was in high school one day, I decided to do something just for fun, and it stuck with me. See, I went to the gym to the cafeteria, and I got one of these plastic spoons that they had in the cafeteria. And it was, you know, lunchtime was about halfway through the day, so my first few classes I didn't have it, but I went and I got it, and at the end of my lunch period, I went and I put it like this. Well, I can't do it with my glasses, I guess, but I put it like that, and I kept it behind my ear. And I walked around the entire rest of the day like this, just for fun, because I'm me, to be funny, to be goofy. And I walked around the school like this the rest of the day. And people started saying, what do you got a spoon behind your ear for? And I said, I don't know, I just did it. And then so everybody thought it was funny. They laughed it out, and it was all good. I went home that day, put my spoon on my little table in my room, and went to bed, did it all the same thing the next day. When I got up to leave the next day to go to school, I decided Well, you know, the first few periods or the first couple periods of my school didn't get to witness the spoon in all its glory. So I went ahead and threw that baby back up there the second day just to go and get another laugh out of some people. And what happened then was different. It didn't become a laugh the second day. It became an identity. And people started calling me Spoon. It became a nickname to me. And so since they started calling me that, I decided I was going to hold on to it. And so I put a little hole in the end of it, and I put a paper clip through it, and I put it on some Mardi Gras beads, and I used to wear it like a necklace, and I used to put little messages down the thing like this, and I would walk around, and everybody knew what it was. And it became who I was. It became my identity. And the thing about that is that identity was not who I was made to be. It was who I made myself to be. See, I was not created to be that person. That person, Spoon, is dead and gone. That person is over. That person did bad things. That person had a rough life. That person didn't want to help nobody. That person was not the identity that God made me to have, but that's the identity that I chose to walk in. And it might sound silly, and it might sound goofy, but people knew the name. As a matter of fact, I don't know if it still happens. That was 18 years ago or more that I did that. And so I don't know it had to have been more. And so I don't know that's necessarily the reason that people did it, but people would come to my mother, and they would say, "Oh, you're Spoon's mom." And that's it. And nobody knew my name. Nobody knew where I lived. Nobody knew none of that. They identified me by what I showed them. They identified me by what I let them identify me by. And the problem is we got a lot of people that are running around, and we don't know who we are anymore. We don't understand the identity that God has given us. And we want to take our spoons, and we want to give ourselves our own identity. And we want to take our failures, and we want to be identified by our failures. And we want to be identified by our weaknesses. And we want to be identified by the things that hurt us, and we want to be identified by the pain that we see. And when people say things to us, we shut off and we say, "If you could just look through my eyes one time, you would understand who I was." And God would say, "If you could just look through my eyes one time, you would understand who I created you to be." Your identity is not found in what you can do. Your identity is found in what I did do. It's not enough to do something today. What we have to do is identify with what Jesus did on that cross. You had two thieves next to Jesus on that cross. I feel like I'm about to get going now. And we had two thieves on that cross with Jesus. And one thief looked at Jesus and said, "If you're the Son of God, get yourself and us off these crosses." But the other thief knew the identity of Jesus, and he identified him as the Son of God. And he said, no, what we did, we deserve to be here. But this is an innocent man. This is a man who doesn't deserve to be here. This is somebody who doesn't need to be in this situation. No, if he should save anybody, he should save himself. But Jesus died not just to save that man on that cross, but to save you and to save me. And to get it going so that years later we could sit in church and we could talk about the identity that we have in Jesus. The identity that is found at the feet of Jesus in the cross. That was what I did to build my identity apart from Jesus. I did whatever I could do to create who I was. Because who I was created to be was apparently not good enough for me. So I felt like I could do it better, and I did it. Have you ever tried to change the identity inside of you that God put there, and God calls you a child of God, and you say, "I understand what you think I am, but God, if you only knew who I was, if you only knew the things that I'd done, if you only knew the places I'd been, if you only seen the things that I seen," and we try to tell God that we're something that we're not, and we try to tell God that we're not savable, that we're not forgivable, that we can't be redeemed, and we try to give God our version of our identity, and God's not impressed with any of it. He says, "I don't care what you think you are. I know what I made, and I know what I created you to be, and I created you to be more. I created you to go beyond. I created you to do new things. I created you to go places where maybe I'm not welcome." And so we take Jesus with us to school, and we take Jesus with us to work until we become identified as Christians. The name Christian is an identity. We're identifying ourselves with Jesus Christ, and so we call ourselves after his name because that is our identity. We find who we are in who he is. We find what we do in what he's done. And we rename our identity every day, and we say things like, well, I'm not good enough. And God says, I'm good enough for both of us. You don't have to be good enough no more. And we say things to God like, I'm so broken. And God said, well, I'm still your healer. And we say things to God like, I've been through too much and you don't understand, God. And he says, but I've carried you through every last bit of it. I've carried you through every struggle, through every trial, when you were down on your knees, when you couldn't take one more step. It wasn't your own perseverance that got you through it. It was the fact that I held you up and I walked with you and I carried you and I did everything I can do so you can see a true reflection of who you are. But we go to the mirror, and when we look at the mirror, we don't see the reflection of Jesus. I see myself. I see the fact that my hair is not where it's supposed to be no more. I see the fact that maybe I'm a little chubbier than I need to be. I see the fact that I wear glasses and my vision isn't as great as maybe it used to be. I see the fact that maybe I'm shorter or taller than other people. Like I'm 35 years old and Ryan is 16 years old. How old are you? 16? Come here. Come here. Come up here. You're going to be in the sermon now. Come here. Come up here. So I'm 35 years old and Ryan is 16 years old. This is not fair right here. You know what I could do with this kind of height? This is not fair right now. But that's what we see, right? Is that what you see, Ryan? You see you the way you see you, don't you? Okay, good talk. Good talk. Have a fun night. Good. God bless you in all that you do. Okay. My point is this. We got to stop seeing things through our eyes and start seeing them through Jesus' eyes. We got to stop seeing. We can't just go by and look at people and go, oh, man, I feel so bad for them. You don't even know them. How are you going to feel bad for them? And when you meet somebody that's on the ground or that's in a low place, you think, I'm not worried about that. They might want to be there. They might choose to be there. It's not my job to get them out of that place. They put themselves there. They'll dig themselves out. But that's not what we do. We're not allowed to see people the way we see them. We have to pray and ask God to give me your eyes, Jesus. Give me your eyes so I can see people the way you see them. I tell you what, I come in here on Sunday and I wear my nice suit and I put it all together and I put my fancy little face microphone, whatever it is, I put that on and I come in here and I keep it all nice and I get what, no matter what happens, I try to look the part and be the part. But can God use me any less in jeans and a football jersey? I bet not. I bet he's going to use me the same way today that he did any other, I almost said last week, but it wasn't me, that he did the week before that he did any other time. I bet you he'll use me the same way today as he will 5 years from now. I bet you that God doesn't care about what I'm wearing or how I look. I bet you that doesn't make me who I am. It doesn't make me my identity. My identity is not found in the clothes that I wear. In fact, let me drop this little humdinger on you. When Jesus was going to be arrested, they had to tell Judas to go and show them who Jesus was. You know what that shows me? Jesus looked so much like everybody else. His identity wasn't wrapped up in his religious robes that everybody else wore. His identity wasn't wrapped up in everything else. And when people looked at Jesus, they saw just another Jew walking the street with a bunch of his buddies. But that's not what Jesus was. Jesus was the Son of God. Jesus was the Savior of the world. Jesus is the person that we run to in our trials, that we run to in our fears, that we run to in our tough times. Jesus is more than what he wore, and so are you. But let me tell you this. I've been the victim of stereotypes. And I've had people look at me and say, let's cross over on the other side of the road and get away from this dude. And I've had people that would be in conversation with me, and they would tell me that the conversation was stopping until I took my sunglasses off because it was just too intimidating, and they didn't want to talk to me with my sunglasses on because they couldn't see my eyes, and it was just a scary situation, and they didn't want to be in it. And I've had people look at me and try to tell me I needed Jesus. You just need Jesus in your life. And I've been invited to go places and serve places. And one of the first things I tell people is, well, I don't really look the part. I got a few tattoos here and there. And so what they say is the same thing every time. Oh, that's all right. We want you because it's you. We want you to do it. It's fine. And then the very thing that they say it's okay later on will get thrown in my face. Well, look at you. You ain't got no right to tell nobody how to live. Look how you look. Walking around looking like some sort of gangbanger. The very thing that people see in you is different than what God sees in you. And when people say it's okay, they don't necessarily mean it's okay. They mean we'll deal with the flaws. But this series is going to show us how to look past our flaws. All of us have flaws. Every one of us has things that we face. Nobody in this room, I would be willing to bet, looks in the mirror and says, "You got it going on." Nobody looks in the mirror and goes, if I had to pick one flaw in you, I'd be here all day long. I just can't. Look at this specimen sitting in front of me right here. Come on now. And you're sitting there trying to get an amen from the sink in the toilet seat because there ain't nobody else in the bathroom with you. And you're like, look at what God made. Jesus, you done did it here, buddy. And we start focusing on the wrong identity. The identity is not what this is. The identity is what's in our heart. The identity is how we treat Jesus. And so when I walk around in my suit and I tell somebody, oh, we just had a great service. And where do you go to church? Oh, I go to church over here at Next Level. I'm actually the pastor of the church. It's great. We just started it just about a year ago, and it's going great. And, you know, you should come out and check us out. And so when I look the part, everybody's willing to hear me. But when I look like this, sometimes people go, no, for real, what do you do? Like, for real. Like, you a corrections officer? Like, what do you do? Like, for real. And nobody wants to take the identity that I tell them because everybody looks through the wrong lens. And it's not okay, but it's what we do. And the problem with that whole scenario is not that necessarily how we look through our lens at other people that we may not know, but until we look at ourselves properly, we can never look at anyone else properly. The identity crisis has to stop in us before we can stop it in anybody else. I can't look at somebody else in love if I look at myself in hatred. I can't look at somebody else with respect if I don't respect myself. If I'm automatically mad at myself for everything I've ever done in my life, I cannot very successfully translate that to say, Dustin, I'm so happy for you. I'm so proud of everything. No, I have to see that in myself. I have to know who I am in Jesus. And I have to say, Jonathan, I am proud of you, man. You've been through some things, but you didn't let them knock you down. You didn't let them keep you out. You kept going. You kept moving strong. And there was a time when I started in ministry that I said, I'm done with this. I don't want this life. This isn't for me. And I filled out my paper to quit the program, and she tore it up and threw it in the garbage because I couldn't do it. But I've made it through. I've made it to be right here today. And it doesn't matter what people do. It doesn't matter what people say. None of that matters. What matters is what God says that we are. And in Genesis, we start reading about how God created everything and that God created man. And he named man and he called him Adam. Adam, you know, we see it as a name. Adam is a name. You probably know somebody named Adam. And so Adam is a name. But the Hebrew word for Adam is not a name. It means man. He named him mankind. He named Adam. It's Adam. He named him man. And so when he named him, he said, I'm going to name you, but I'm going to give you the right to name everything else and to subdue the world and to run this place. This is your show. I made you. You're good to go. You do what you got to do. And as soon as Adam got the chance, and he named everything that he could. And that's what we do in our life. We name our situation. We name our job. We name our family. We name our circumstance. And then we look at ourselves and we name ourselves and we say it's your fault. And we name ourselves failure. And we name ourselves losers. And we name ourselves fat. And we name ourselves bald. And we name ourselves not good enough. And we name ourselves broken. And we name ourselves every other thing that we can name ourselves, all the while forgetting that we don't have the right to name what God's already named. Amen. We don't have the right to change what God has already put into perspective here. And he was told to be fruitful, to rule the earth and to subdue it. That means to really just take control and to be the authority in the earth, to subdue it, to put it under your power. And so when did we stop doing this? When did God change the right? When did God change our job description and say, okay, now you guys have done enough. You don't need to subdue no more. No, we are the children of God. We have the authority to walk and do what we need to do. We have the ability to be what he's called us to be. And we don't live and subdue no more because we've given our authority away. Well, I'm telling you here today, it's not going to be gone for long because Jonathan's about to start taking his authority back. I'm not going to let myself get beat down no more. I'm not going to let myself be talked to negative no more. I don't care if people like it. I don't care if people judge. I don't care if people have something nice to say or not nice to say. I'm not here for that. I'm here for Jesus. And if Jesus is calling me to do something, guess what I'm going to do? Exactly what he's called me to do. I can't live my life in fear of everybody else. I can live my life to serve Jesus and only Jesus and nothing but Jesus. So help me God, as long as I live. But let me tell you the importance of that. Unplanned and unbeknownst to me, the Kids Church is starting a new series today too. And their series is about the identity that they have in Jesus. I did not plan that. That the ministry that they do, I believe in them to do. I don't have to micromanage what they do. They are great leaders. I don't have to be a part of that. And so just understand, you come up and you say, I want to lead a ministry. I'm not going to micromanage you. I'm going to be there for you. But if I put you in a leadership position, it's because I trust you as a leader. And so I don't micromanage what they do. And some kind of way, God said, I appreciate the fact that you're going to talk about identity and who people are in Jesus. And you're going to talk about reflections and you're going to talk about finding who you are. But what it's not good enough that we know it. We got to start teaching this stuff to the kids too, because these kids are growing up and they don't know who they are no more. And they think that they can identify with whatever else is out there, and one day they're going to come into the living room and they're going to say, Mom, I've decided I'm not a boy no more. I'm going to be a plant, and I want you to call me Seymour, because that's what I want to be. I want to be a plant, and I want you to come in and I want you to water me, and I'm just going to stand right here and I don't have to go to school no more because I've decided that I'm going to be a plant. That's foolishness. These kids need to start taking back their authority the same way we need to take back our authority, the same way we need to walk in who we are in Jesus. We need to start teaching the children the same thing, that it's not enough for them just to grow up and take what society says as normal, that they grow up and take what the Bible says as truth, what the Bible says as normal, what the Bible says, that we build walls around our families and we say, I will not let you. You can do what you want to do. Maybe your kids are grown. Maybe they're not. Maybe your kids are teenagers. I'm in that boat, so we're right there paddling together. But what I'm going to do is say this. You do what you need to do, and no matter what you do, no matter what you say, no matter how far you go, no matter what you live, I am not going to stop praying. I am not going to stop surrounding you with the presence of God, because I know who you were made to be, and that is not it. I know what you were created to do, and you're not doing it. And so don't just sit there and look at it like it's all good and it'll work itself out. We got to be productive and start saying, I'm done with this. We're going to start doing what we need to do in Jesus' name, and bring Jesus back to the middle of this city, and bring Jesus back to the middle of this country, and bring Jesus in all authority right back to this earth. Amen. I'm tired of losing. I'm not ready to lose no more. I'm getting a little warm, so I'm going to take this jacket off. And you're going to see the fullness of my non-pastoral look. But it's not enough for us to know who we are if we don't operate in it. It's not enough for us to know who we are if we don't live every day like that. We got to stop identifying as something that we're not. See, Adam identified as a victim, and he lost everything that God gave him. And Moses identified as unqualified and said, God, I'm not ready to lead these people. I can't do what you're asking me to do. I can't be what you're asking me to be. But God said, do it anyway. And David, as I identified as a failure when his kids turned against him and his kingdom was ripped apart and one son's raping his sister and the other kids are trying to take the kingdom, and David's life was a mess. And all David could say was, God, it is... It is you and you alone that I have sinned against. And God seen himself as a failure. Or not God, that was not true. David seen himself as a failure. Paul identified as a sinner. Paul, probably one of the greatest apostles, if not the greatest apostle in all of the Bible, who called himself the chief among sinners. Paul, who would go in and straighten something up just by writing a letter, and he would fix everything. Paul, who walked in such authority and power that even the original disciples didn't want to be around him because he was just too bad. That same Paul looked at himself and said, I am the chief among sinners. But then there's Jesus. And thank God for Jesus, because Jesus identified as a man. And Jesus came to this earth and put on flesh and lived a sin-free life. How many people can sit here and say they've lived a sin-free life? Nobody. How many people can say that they've lived a sin-free hour? Probably nobody. But Jesus lived 33 years until he hit the cross sin-free. Why did he do it? Did he do it just to say, I've done it? No, he did it because he knew there was a sin price that had to be paid. He knew there was something in my life in 2017 that I was going to have to deal with, that he was going to have to cover. He knew there was something in your life in 2017 that you were going to have to deal with, that he was going to have to cover. Jesus identified with a man to allow us to identify as free. Jesus identified as the sinner so that we can identify with God. Jesus allowed us to walk through a door that had been closed for so long, and I'm so thankful for his identity crisis, because it's his identity crisis that lets me know exactly who I am. Exactly who I am. I'm free. I'm a child of God. I'm everything that he's called me to be. And we like to look at this kid in this book and in this story here in Luke, and we like to call him the prodigal son, but the Bible never called him the prodigal son. My Bible even says at the top of the page, the prodigal son. The writing never says the prodigal son. The writing says a lost son who wasted his money on prodigal living. See, we identify things the wrong way, and then that's how it sticks to you. So because you did this, now you're labeled a failure your whole life. Because you were arrested one time, now you're labeled as a criminal for the rest of your life. And they say you got to turn it around, and you got to get back to society, and you got to fix it up. But it's hard to get back to society when everybody looks at you by what you used to be. It's hard to get back to society and do the things that you need to do when everybody identifies you by what your failures were and not what your successes are. And so the word prodigal in Hebrew is asotos. It means corrupt, loose, or abandoned. And what this is saying is that he had gotten so away from himself that he abandoned everything he knew. His living was abandoning everything he knew. So let me be an encouragement to you that if you're in the room and you have children and your children aren't acting right, let me just tell you this. When they abandon themselves, it has nothing to do with you. He didn't leave his family because of who they were. He didn't leave his family because of what his job was. He didn't leave his family for any other reason than he lost who he was. And when he abandoned himself, everything else just followed. And so what we have to do is we got to start praying, and we got to start saying, God, let me find those abandoned people. Let me find those people who are lost. Let me find those people who are outside of your will, and let me bring them close to you. Let me allow me to be the vessel that would bring these people closer to you each and every day. Let me be that person. The Bible actually describes people as two ways. You're either lost or you're found. You're either lost or you're found. You're either saved or you're a sinner. There is no in the middle. There is no, well, he doesn't go to church, but he's a really good guy. There's plenty of really good guys that are not going to see Jesus when it's all over with. That's what this chapter is all about. We label people with different labels, and we cause people to forget who they are. We cause ourselves to forget who we are, and we need to stop identifying with the ways of this world. We are supposed to be in this world, but not of this world. We are supposed to be ambassadors for Jesus. We are supposed to be the people who show a world Jesus, who show a world that there's hope, who show a world that there's more. I am supposed to identify with him. I am supposed to identify with God's word. I am supposed to identify with what he did. And the moment you start having an identity crisis is the moment you need to turn around and you need to look to the cross and you need to say, and this is where I find my identity. And it doesn't matter how I see myself. What matters is how he sees me. And it doesn't matter, Jerry, I love you, but it doesn't matter how you see me. What matters is how what happens here. And it doesn't matter what Ryan thinks of me. If he thinks I'm a little short dude, what matters is that I'm focusing right here and finding my real identity. And it doesn't matter what Dustin thinks of me. What matters is that I'm focusing right here and finding my real identity. The minute we get back to the cross, the minute we get back to Jesus, is the minute we get back to who we were created to be. We got to stop living as broken, depressed, beat up, beat down people and start living the life that God called us to live and being the people that God called us to be and walking around with our heads held high and saying, I don't care if you like it. I don't care if you like this church. I don't care if you like our music. I don't care if you like my preaching style. I'm going to do what God called me to do and I'm going to just speak this Bible. And if it offends you, I'm sorry, but the same door you came in, you can walk right back out of. There's other churches that'll tickle your earlobes. I'm not the one. If you don't like the things that I say, I'm sorry. I'm going to keep it rooted right here. And I don't mean to offend and I don't mean to upset. But if the Bible says it, then I'm going to cherish it as God's written word, as God's living word. And it doesn't matter if you've been told you're a failure. Let me tell you, you're not. And it doesn't matter if you've been told that you're broken. You're not. And it doesn't matter that you've been told that you'll never be anything? That's not true. That's not true at all. So what we have to do is get back to the identity of who Jesus created us to be. I see myself in the cross so I can find myself in Jesus. The great, great, wise, all-knowing philosopher from back in the early 1900 era said it like this: I am what I am, and that's all that I am. And if you don't know who that is, that's Popeye the Sailor Man. And if you still don't know who that is, then we can get you a library card and you go check out some Popeye DVDs and you could get your life right. Huh? I don't know if they have them, but if they don't, we need to look it up on the interwebs or something. Get your life right. Get saved. Find Jesus and understand who Popeye is. We need to get that Popeye the Sailor Man anointing on us to say, I am what I am. You don't have to like me. God didn't call you to like me. God didn't call me to impress you. Listen, I've spent plenty of time trying to be something that I'm not. I've tried to preach it like other people. I've tried to live like other people. I've tried to say things that other people said. I've tried to change the way I talk, only to realize that it is exactly me being me that God wants to use. He doesn't want me to be Pastor Josh. He doesn't want me to be Chris. He wants me to be me. He wants me to live the life that he's called for me. So I refuse anymore to do it. I'm not going to live my life trying to be somebody else. I try and try and try every single week to finish this early and to get out of here at a decent time. It's just not happening. I'm sorry. Not sorry. Sorry, not sorry. I'm doing what I can, but I believe if I'm still talking, it's because Jesus is still talking. And I'm going to shut it down as soon as I can, but now that I've finished my introduction, let me get into my actual message. Let me give you four facts of the identity crisis, and then we're out. Four facts about the identity crisis. Our identity is worth more than our wealth. See, in verses 13 and 14, you'll read that he went to another country and he started wasting all his money with everything else. And he found his identity in his money because when he had his money, he had his friends. He had his buddies who were willing to go out and hang out with him. He had people around him who wanted to spend time with him, because how many people know that when you're at the top of your game, everybody wants to come be your friend then? Yeah. Yep. But when you're not, nobody wants to talk to you. But when you got something to offer somebody else, everybody's hanging out. Until it all dries up, until it all goes away. And so he found who he was by what he had. And so many times we find who we are based on what we have. well, I've made it. I had somebody tell me, and he didn't mean it this way, but it is the way a lot of people mean it. He has a very nice truck, a Cadillac Escalade. You know, that's my favorite truck in the world. So he had one, and it was real nice. And he said, you know, I don't drive it a lot because I don't want people to think that I'm, you know, better than them. I wanted it for me. I like it. And he said, but it's a symbol. It symbolizes that you've made something, that you've made it. You've kind of got there. You have that nice truck, and so it's good. But see, that's what people do. While that wasn't his thought, that is a lot of people's thought. And a lot of people's thought is that if I can just make enough money to have enough stuff to do enough things, then people will want to be around me, and I will find my identity based on what I have. My worth will be connected to my wealth. And your worth is never connected to your wealth. That's a lie that is told to you every single day. That's a lie that we live in. And listen, I'm not exempt. I've said it. We've said it. I go to God and I said, God, I would make a great rich person. I would give money to everybody that needs it. Oh, Dustin, you're having a car situation? Let me buy you a new car. I mean, God, just give me like millions because I'm throwing them a brand new car. You know, I'm doing whatever. God, I would be a great rich person. And we've proved it. We've done it when we had money, and we've done it when we haven't had money. And so it's not about finding our identity in what we do with our funds. It's not about finding our worth in what we do with our wealth. It's about finding our identity in Jesus. And why do we help people? Not because we're rich, not because we're millionaires, not because that's our identity. We help people because Jesus helped people. We help people because he said, as you treat the least of these, you've treated me. And so I want to treat everybody I can the same way that I would treat Jesus. And if I don't like somebody, that's fine, but I'm going to respect that person, and I'm going to care about that, and I'm going to make sure I do everything I do to represent Jesus in that situation. And Jesus illustrated it like this with the widow with the two mites. He sat across from the treasury, and he watched everybody bring in their big gifts. And everybody was putting in more and more and more. And this little old widow lady came in with two mites, which is about a penny. And she came in, and she dropped it in there. And Jesus stopped everything. And he said, look at this woman. He said, she just gave more than all of you. Because you're giving out of your abundance to be seen by everybody, but she gave out of her sacrifice. And her identity became connected to what Jesus said she was. And now everywhere you go and everywhere you hear this Bible preached, and every time you get in this word, you can go to Luke chapter 21 and you can read it for yourself, that this woman was identified by what she did in Jesus' presence and how she acted with Jesus. It wasn't about, she didn't go and drop it in there so she could be seen like everybody else. She went and dropped it in there because it was the right thing to do. Not because she had it, not because she was rich, not because she had it all put together, but because she knew what she had to do, and Jesus stopped everything. See, when we start living in our true identity, Jesus will stop everything that's going on around us, and he will say, look right here. Look at what they're doing. Look at what this person is doing. I done showed them some things. I done put some things in their heart. Now they're going to start living a different way. Why, Jesus? Because I want them to know who they are in me, not in what they have. And we try to find who we are in what we have. And he doesn't want us to plan for what we don't have. He wants us to perform with what we do have. Number two, our identity is endangered by emptiness. Our identity is endangered by emptiness. Verse 16, he would have gladly filled his stomach with the pods that the swine ate. You know, when you read about John the Baptist and you read that John the Baptist ate locusts and wild honey, and you think, why is he eating bugs? These pods comes from the word that it means locust. And so the pods that John, the locust that John the Baptist ate actually speaks of a fruit, a very sweet fruit that was given to fatten up livestock for killing so that they could eat them. It was a sign of, you know, if you had fat cow, that's how this prodigal son came home to a party. And so what the pod is not made for people to eat, but people of a lower financial class in this day would fill themselves with the pods because that's what they could afford. And so what he's saying is, you left everything to swallow nothing. You left everything you had so you could eat what was less than what God created for you. And what we do is we stop eating the bread of life. We stop feeding on God's word and we start feeding on everything else that's going on. Oh, did you see that new episode of Scandal? Is that even a TV show anymore? Did you watch Empire last week, Jerry? Oh, Empire had it going on, baby. You should have seen whatever the dude's name and whatever the chick's name, they got into a fight and it was just crazy. Maybe we should stop watching so much Empire and start watching some more Jesus. I'm just saying. I mean, maybe that's just me, and I'm just being a little crazy and a little radical. I mean, I don't know. Maybe that's just me. But maybe if we started finding our identity in the right places, we would stop filling ourselves with everything but Jesus. We fill ourselves with worry. We fill ourselves with pain. We fill ourselves with fear. We fill ourselves with everything that we have. Let me encourage you in this fact. God does not form stuff that he doesn't want to fill. And he's formed each and every one of us. He formed the earth and he filled it with life. He formed the temple and he filled it with glory. He formed man and he filled him with life and with purpose and with a plan that when we do what we need to do in Jesus, we have everything that you need to have. You want to understand what it's like to fill yourself with the wrong stuff? You want to understand what it's like to live in a purpose that's not yours? Take your shoes off and put them on the other feet. First of all, it's uncomfortable. Secondly, it messes up your walk. When we start filling things that are not supposed to be filled like that, it's the same way. It's uncomfortable for us. When I start identifying with something that's not Jesus, it's uncomfortable. Secondly, it messes up my walk. I can't truly walk for Jesus if I'm not living that identity out in my life. I can say it, and I can put on the nice show, and I can use the Christian lingo, and I can do it all. But if I'm not truly finding my identity right here in Jesus Christ, then it's going to be the same consequence as wearing my shoes backwards, and it's going to mess up my walk. Our walk is truly what it's supposed to be when we know where it comes from. Let me. Has anybody ever heard this? There's a God-shaped hole in all of us. Said the Bible says that there's a God-shaped hole in all of us. That's what the Bible says. The Bible says that. That's not what the Bible says. That's actually what a man named Blaise Pascal said. That's not even in the Bible. So if you thought it was in the Bible, let me correct your theology right now. That was actually a French philosopher that said that, and this is what he said. He had a long quote, and this is what it said. There was once in a man true happiness, of which all that now remains is an empty print and a trace. Since this infinite abyss can be filled only with an infinite and immutable object, in other words, only by God himself. And that has turned into there's a God-shaped hole in everybody. But it's true. And we try to fill it with everything we can. Trust me, I've tried to fill the hole myself. I'm not standing up here saying, you can't do that. I've filled it with everything else. I've tried to fill it with everything other than what he's called me to be. And it doesn't work. The only thing that truly fills the emptiness in us is when we get with Jesus. The third fact is our identity is realized by relationship. It's realized by relationship. The Bible said he came to himself. In other words, he realized who he was and who his father was. And he said, I'm worth more than this. He got up and he said, wait a minute. How many of my father's hired servants have more than I have right now? But I'm sitting here starving to death and I'm actually a son. And so what he did was he said, I'm going to go back to my father and I'm going to say, Dad, I messed up. And I know I can't be your son no more, but just make me a servant. And we give up what we are for anything just to get closer to the table. And we walk away and we say, I don't want this. And then when we come back, we say, I know it can't be the same, but can you please just bless me? And there has to be a time when we look at the right thing and we say, we've done this all the wrong way. He came to himself. He came to himself. How many people in this room need to come to themselves? I'll put my hand up. I'm okay with it. How many people at different times need to come to themselves and say, God, I've not been living what you've called me to live. I've been letting everything else in this world identify me. I've been identified by my problems. I've been identified by my pain. I've been identified by everything other than who you are in my life. And I'm tired of it, God. And I need to come to myself right now. The last thing is this. Our identity is found and our Father. See, the Bible says that while he was still a long way off, the Father saw him and had mercy on him. Did you know that while you were still a long way off, before you ever thought about finding Jesus or running to God, that the Father looked at you and had mercy on you? and said, I know where you've been. I know what you've done. And you think you're not good enough now because of what you've done. That's not true. I don't care what you've done. I don't care what you've been through. I don't care what you've walked in. Your identity is found in your Father. I'm going to finish with this story, and some of you I know have heard it, so if you have, forgive the redundance. If you haven't, just listen. And I'm sure people on the internet haven't heard it, so if nothing else, it's for them. Everybody knows, I'm sure, that I grew up without a father, and that my father left, and that it was all good. Not good. Not good for him. Terrible for me. But he didn't want to be burdened with children, so he left us when I was young. I have no memories of him. And then I remember going and staying up there for a little while, and I remember him letting me sit on his drums and play his drums because he was a drummer, and I thought that was cool. You know, that's cool. But if I'm looking for my identity, I can't find it in a set of drums. See, so many people, their dad is the one that teaches them stuff. The other day, I had Isaiah up in the bathroom, and Chastity has a picture of it, but I was teaching him how to shave because he's at that point now. And so I was teaching him how to shave, and so she took a picture, actually, which if I thought ahead, I might would have showed it on the screen because it's really funny. But it's him with shaving cream on his face and me with shaving cream all over my head. But your father teaches you these things, and I didn't have that. So my identity couldn't be found in my father. It had to be found in something else. It had to be found in the things that I could do. It had to be found in the things that I could do. And so I determined that I would never let that stuff happen again. So I did what I did, and I lived my life. And then one day, when I was about 10 years old, it was my birthday. So it was almost 10 years ago today. Or not 10 years ago today. That would mean I'm 20. 25 years ago today. Thank you. I'm terrible at math. So 25 years ago around this time, my dad decided he was going to come back and be a part of the family. And I was so excited. I was like, this is the greatest day ever. This is going to be the bomb. And it was on my birthday too, so I knew it was going to be fresh. And so he came back and he brought me the cheapest gift you could ever get in your life. It was a styrofoam airplane that it was $5, and it took all of 37 seconds to build. You open it, you put the big piece in the other big piece, you put a couple stickers on it, you're done. But it was from my dad, so it was the best thing ever. And I went outside, and it was dark out, and we lived in a rough place. We lived in a trailer park, and I don't judge me if you want to, but it's where we was at the time, you know, for where you're at. So we sat out there, and we started throwing this paper airplane in our little tiny yard, I guess you could call it, our plot, whatever. We started throwing this airplane. And it felt like forever, and it was the greatest time of my life. And my dad said he was done with drugs. He was done with all that. He wanted to be with his family. And I said, yes. And I remember a little while later, he came back, and he'd had enough. And he'd had enough of not having drugs. So he went back to doing what he was doing. And he went back to living his life. And so he came back, and he was looking for a fight. And I pushed my body against the door with all of my strength. And I held it like this. And I braced myself. And I was pushing and pushing. And he was beating on the other side of the door because he wanted to come in and hit my mother. And I said, I can't let it happen. And I'm only 10 years old. And I'm giving it everything I can. God, this is not the identity you called me to have. But he got in and started swinging his arms around and doing what he could do. And I remember my mom told me I jumped on his back. And she said at that moment, she said nobody had defended her. And at that moment, I became her hero because I was willing to give everything to defend her. And Jesus was willing to get everything to defend us. And when we live according to the wrong identity, we take what he did and we say, I appreciate it, Jesus, but it's not quite good enough for me. And after my dad did what he needed to do, he left and I never saw him again. And that was my final memory, was getting beat on and having stuff thrown at me through the door. Thanks, Dad. I appreciate it. You built a real legacy here. But then years went by, and a few years ago, I got a call that my dad wanted to find me, and I thought he passed away. And I got a call that my dad was looking for me, so I told my mother to give him my number, and he called me. And when he called me, he started crying, and I said, I don't know why I'm telling you this, but I need you to go read this in the Bible. Do you have a Bible? He said, yeah, he read it. And then he called me the next day, and he was crying, and I said, what's the matter? He said, I've done nothing but be bad to you guys. I've left you. I've left you alone. I've never been there for you guys, and you guys have grown up to be great people, and I have nothing to do with it. And all I know is that I need help and I need a change. And I wanted to know, would you pray that Jesus would forgive me too, the way he's forgiven you? And I said, of course I will. And at that moment, the bad things when I was 10 years old, all the pain was taken away because my identity was found in my Father. No. Not my earthly Father. It was found in my heavenly Father. It was found in the person who never left me, who never walked away from me. My identity was found right then because I could give to the person love that never gave it to me. And then he got sick and he got cancer. And I was coming back from Ecuador, and I flew to St. Louis to spend time with him. And I'm sorry, this is a long close, but I got to get it out. I went up there to be with him, and he couldn't move really good, and he couldn't eat by himself, and he barely could walk, and he could say a few things here and there, and he always had real long hair, and his hair was gone because of chemo treatment, and everything that was going on was different now, and he wasn't the person that I thought he was. I was looking for a big guy who would be an imposing force, and I saw a frail, weak, small individual who could impose no harm to nobody. And I looked at him, and I spent a few days with him. And I fed him his food, and I helped him get to the bathroom. And when he fell asleep on the chair, I covered him up, and I was leaving. And he said, will you pray with me one more time? Because I don't think I'm going to make it much longer, and I just want to make sure that I'm okay when I see God. And I said, I would love to. And I prayed with him again, and I left. And then a few days later, I got the call that my dad had died. And I thought I was going to get to have a relationship now that I never got to have. But what's more important is that the relationship I get now will last forever. It will never be taken away from me again. I will never have to deal with the fact of losing what I thought I needed my whole life. My identity is found not by him, but right here. And when I knew who I was in Jesus, I could give that to somebody else. If we don't know who we are, we can't help nobody. Let's pray. God, be with us today. Thank you for your word. Thank you for everything that you've done. I pray that you have been felt, that your word has been heard, that you have spoken to your people. And right now, God, I pray that you would help us get through any identity crisis that we may be facing. Father, use this time as only you can. Speak to our hearts.
Thank you for taking a few minutes to be a part of our service today. We pray you were blessed and encouraged by our time together. If you're in the Fort Wayne area and you do not have a home church, we would love for you to come by and visit Next Level anytime. For more information, you can go to our website, www.nlcfw.org. You can also find us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. If you have not made the decision to follow Jesus but would like to, we would like to pray with you right now. Simply from your heart say, Father, I am a sinner. I give myself to you right now. Take my heart, clean me, use me, and make me your child today, in Jesus' name. If you prayed that prayer, then congratulations. You can contact us on Facebook or on email anytime and let us know so that we can celebrate with you. We pray you have a blessed day. God bless you.